Yes, we're live. You may start, Harsha.
Just a second. Can you hear me now, Shashank?
Yes, yes.
All right. Let me just start the class now. All right, so good evening, everyone. Welcome to another very exciting episode or exciting lecture on the hidden mysteries of our planet. You see, the Earth has been here for a very, very long time. And despite us having so much of technology, so much of knowledge at our fingertips today, we still don't understand all the mysteries that are engulfed within this planet. There are so many things, so many phenomena that are not explained, and we are here trying to solve them. You have researchers, you have scientists, you have explorers, you have a lot of different kinds of people who are trying to debunk a lot of myths, a lot of theories, trying to explain a lot of unexplainable phenomena of the planet. And let us see how far they've succeeded in this lecture. So the Earth is the only planet in our galaxy that supports life. There are so many mysteries engulfed inside her that we are unable to explain even today, even the 21st century. In this chapter, let us delve into some of those mysteries and learn with a sense of overawed wonderment to say that there is so much more that we don't understand. And let us say right now that we don't know everything. Okay? And I'll show you some of the mysteries that are so baffling that will really, really open your eyes to a lot of mysteries out there. So I'm hoping that one day, some of these mysteries or probably all of these mysteries will be explained, right? And then we can have a new appreciation for our planet. So the first mystery that I want to talk to you about is known as the Bermuda Triangle Mystery. Now, Bermuda Triangle Mystery hasn't been solved so far. So Bermuda Triangle actually exists somewhere in the Atlantic Ocean. It's found between Florida, Puerto Rico, and Bermuda. It's a triangle. And in this triangle, a lot of mysterious things happen. Ships and planes disappear without any trace, without any wreckage. When the planes fly into this area, they're not able to send any distress signal. They're not able to radio. They're not able to follow their compass, right? Ships have disappeared. Their crew have disappeared without any trace. Thousands of ships and hundreds of planes have gone under the water in this place, and no one has a clue as to what is happening there today. There are various theories as to why it happens, but these theories are not accepted by everyone. So just a few pictures about the Bermuda Triangle, and then I'll talk to you about some of the fascinating things that happened there. So the Bermuda Triangle is also known as the Devil's Triangle, and it is a stretch of Atlantic Ocean between Florida, Bermuda, and Puerto Rico. It is a big mystery as several planes and ships seem to disappear mysteriously over that area. In 1942, when Christopher Columbus sailed over the Bermuda Triangle, right, he made a note in his diary, and he said he saw some strange lights in the sky. He also saw some flames of fire falling into the ocean. And that's the first record of the Bermuda Triangle that we have today. Then in 1945, there was actually a group of flights known as Flight 19. Okay, they were Avenger torpedo bombers that flew over the Bermuda Triangle. And these were actually Navy planes, right? Fighter planes. When there were five of them, and when they flew over the Bermuda Triangle, immediately they got into some kind of problem. They lost all kinds of contact, okay, with the radio tower, and they were not even able to send a distress signal. And suddenly they disappeared. They disappeared from radar, and till today, no one knows what happened to them. 4 hours after they took off and then they disappeared from radar, the Navy sent another rescue plane after them in order to help them find their way back. And even this rescue plane, after 20 minutes, completely disappeared. And we have no idea what happened to that rescue plane even today. 1945, they went, then they disappeared. And today, 2020, we have no idea what happened to them. We have not found any wreckage. We have not found any bodies. We have no possible explanation as to how these planes disappeared. Thousands of ships and planes simply vanished without any warning call. So even these planes, even the radio or if even their signs of distress, their emergency weapons that they have at their disposal, it can be a life raft, it can be, you know, it can be a radio signal. None of it can be heard. Everything just stops and they disappear. Right? Sometimes many ships have been found coming out of the Bermuda Triangle, but the crew is completely missing. There are no people on the ship. No one knows what happened to them on the ship. Just the ship is found. Sometimes there's a dog or a parrot that is left behind on the ship, but no survivor that can actually talk and tell you what happened. People just vanished. So there was once a pilot known as Bruce Gernon, and he was flying over the Bermuda Triangle. Suddenly, he found that his plane was covered with a thick fog, and there was a small tunnel that was created in this fog. So he entered this fog. And as he was flying into the fog, it took him 3 minutes to get from one end of the tunnel to the other end of the tunnel over the Bermuda Triangle, right? After he got out of the fog, he started to radio for help, and he started getting in contact back with civilization. He discovered that he was over Miami City, having covered 160 kilometers in just 3 minutes. This means that his plane would have to actually have traveled 3,000 kilometers per hour. Okay, and his plane can actually only travel at 300 kilometers per hour. That's the top speed. But his plane somehow, mysteriously, magically, flew at a speed of 3,000 kilometers per hour and covered 160 kilometers in just 3 minutes. It is impossible for any of us to imagine how that even happened. So this kind of mystery actually happens over the Bermuda Triangle. And even today, we don't have a proper scientific explanation as to what happened. Many theories have been developed to explain the disappearances, but none are accepted widely. Theories about alien abductions. Many people say there are a race of aliens that live in the Bermuda Triangle, or aliens come and then they take away the ships and take away the planes, right, as specimens. They take away people to do experiments on them. They take them off to their own planet. But we don't know if it is true because there is no evidence of that. Other supernatural causes have also been said, such as you have these huge tidal waves that are actually created in the Bermuda Triangle that sink ships. But when you have huge tidal waves, how are the planes crashing? How are the planes disappearing? It doesn't explain that. So we have rogue waves, powerful storms, mysterious sea creatures, mysterious geomagnetic anomalies that creates navigational problems for pilots and somehow causes them to plunge into the water. But we don't know for sure. We can't say this is the actual theory as to what is happening in Bermuda Triangle, and that is why planes and ships are missing. Now I want to talk to you about one of the ships that entered the Atlantic Ocean. It's known as Mary Celeste, right? And she was found abandoned on the 5th of December, 1872, about 740 kilometers away from Portugal. On the 8th of November, the ship set sail to New York with over 1,700 barrels of alcohol, right? It was planning to go to Italy. On board were 10 people, a crew of 10 people. The ship was discovered 24 days later, but the crew had completely disappeared. The ship was found. It had sailed through the Atlantic Ocean. It had gone through Bermuda Triangle. And then you see that the ship survived. The alcohol cargo that was there was intact. Nothing had damaged it. But the crew was missing. And even today, we don't know what happened to the crew. Now, I'll take your attention to another very interesting fact, another very interesting theory about a continent known as Atlantis. In this place, there was a lost city known as Atlantis, and it's actually believed that Atlantis was the most developed city in the world. Even today, people say that the technology that the people of Atlantis had over 11,000 years ago is not found in the 20th century. Like, we don't have that kind of technology that they had 11,000, 12,000 years ago. So this was what Atlantis City probably looked like. And researchers say Atlantis City is somewhere underwater now. It's covered by the Atlantic Ocean. But we don't know for sure where the city is and what has happened to the city. Right, I'm just shuffling through some pictures about the city of Atlantis. and what it would have looked like. So the lost city of Atlantis was first mentioned by the Greek philosopher Plato about 2,300 years ago. According to Plato, this kingdom existed about 9,000 years before his time. And mysteriously, the city suddenly disappeared one day, and no one knows why. Narrations, people suggest that the city is said to have sunk into the sea after an earthquake or tsunami struck the city. But again, there is no proof of that. Legend says the Atlantis city was built by Poseidon, one of the Greek gods, right? He's the god of the sea, of storms and earthquakes, when he fell in love with a human known as Cleito. Okay, he made the city on top of a hill to keep her isolated and to protect her. And he named the city Atlantis. And the people of Atlantis actually belong to this god. That is folklore and stories of what people say about Atlantis. Okay, so the new home built by Poseidon for his love in the city of Atlantis was surrounded by rings of water and land. Five rings of water were connected to the land with the help of five tunnels. Okay, were a huge canal connected outer rings of water to ocean. So these tunnels were so big that even ships could go through them, right? And the city was covered with water and was protected by water. Stories also claim that the original inhabitants of the lost city of Atlantis are believed to be of extraterrestrial origin, okay, who reached there about 50,000 years ago from the Lyrian star system. That means they said that the inhabitants of Atlantis were aliens, right, that came from a different solar system, from a different galaxy altogether, and they built this city with their technology, right? And then suddenly they decided to leave and then they disappeared. So there are various theories about Atlantis. You can do a lot of research. I want you to go read. You can see a lot of documentaries. It's on YouTube, right? And find out what happened to Atlantis, what you think is the most probable cause as to why Atlantis disappeared. And most important of all, where Atlantis was located, right? You can do a research on that. So ocean explorer Robert Ballard says, a highly advanced society lived in the island of Santorini in the Aegean Sea near Greece. This island was hit with a massive volcanic eruption and the society disappeared instantly, similar to what happened to Atlantis. So probably these people that lived in the sea, on the island of Aegean Sea, were people of Atlantis, and because of the volcanic eruption, they disappeared. But again, that's another theory. Ignatius Dolly confirms the existence and disappearance of a mid-Atlantic continent that was in the exact location that Plato had mentioned. So you have various oceanographers, you have various researchers, scientists, all of them saying that there is evidence of a city known as Atlantis that had disappeared, but we're not able to tell you exactly where it is found, because there's so many people who've written about it for thousands of years, and all the descriptions about Atlantis, about the way it was and the way it looked, are similar. So probably they would have seen it, or they would have come in close contact with it, at least the remnants of the city of once what it was, and they would have described it as it was, and now you don't have that continent anymore. Few researchers claim that the Ethiopian kingdom was a real continent located off the Bahamas, the island of Bahamas, and was swallowed up by the Bermuda Triangle later. While another group suggested the current Antarctica is the newest version of Atlantis, right? So, as I said, there are too many theories trying to explain what happened to Atlantis, where it was located, and where it might be found today as well. But I think only time will tell. Now, another mystery, okay, known as the Nazca Lines. Can you see these lines? These lines cannot be seen when you're on the ground. You have to see them from the sky. And only when we invented the plane did modern civilization actually discover Nazca Lines. But there were a lot of people living before the plane was invented around the Nazca Lines, but they could not make out the shapes because they were so big in size. They were hundreds of kilometers long. Each design is about hundreds of kilometers long. So when you are standing on the ground, you will not realize that you are part of a pattern. And these lines actually belong to some form of a diagram that were made by ancient civilizations earlier. But when the plane was invented and pilots flew over the Nazca lines, they could discover that it forms a pattern. And sometimes it formed a plant. The pattern was in form of a plant, in the form of an animal, right? Something, sometimes you don't understand what it was. Sometimes it was a bird. So these are all the Nazca lines that actually do not have a proper explanation as to who created these lines, when were they created, when was the exact time they were created. There are arbitrary dates as to when these lines were created. We don't know for what purpose they were created. Again, there are theories as to why these lines were created. So I'll come to those theories in a bit. Now this Nazca line looks like it's in the form of a monkey, similar to a monkey, right? I don't know what this looks like. This looks like a bird, probably a hummingbird, but there are hundreds of kilometers long. And how did ancient civilizations about 11,000, 12,000 years ago, okay, have the technology to actually construct or build something like this? Now this looks like a bird again. So the Nazca lines are a collection of giant geoglyphs. Now, what are geoglyphs, right? They're designs etched onto the ground. Okay, these Nazca lines are found in a place called Peru in South America. They were created by the ancient Nazca civilization in South America about 2000 years ago. But it could be before that as well. Nazca lines can only be fully appreciated when viewed from the air, given their massive size. As I already said, these lines are hundreds of kilometers long. So when you are on the ground, you see a line that is running hundreds of kilometers, you can't make out whether it's part of an image or not. But when you fly over it, when you're in the plane, from the top, you can see the entire picture. And then you can say, yeah, it belongs to, an image. So despite being studied for 80 years, right, these geoglyphs, which were designated UNESCO World Heritage Site in 1994, are still a mystery to researchers today. Even today, the top scientists are not able to explain, okay, why these lines were created, or probably how these lines were created. So there are three basic types of Nazca lines. You have straight lines, you have geometric designs, and you have pictorial representations. There are more than 800 straight lines on the coastal plains, some of which are like 48 kilometers long. So you can just imagine how big these geoglyphs are. Additionally, there are over 300 geometric designs, which include basic shapes such as triangles, rectangles, trapezoids, as well as spirals, arrows, zigzags, wavy lines, right? And Nazca lines are perhaps best known for the representation about 70 animals and plants, some of which measure about 1,200 feet. That's 370 meters long, right? The examples include spiders, hummingbirds, cactus plants, monkeys, whales, llamas, ducks, and goes on. So these Nazca lines were created by the civilization, but we don't know why. And they were so beautiful, they were so long and so gigantic that with a naked eye on the ground, you could not make out. So anthropologists believe the Nazca culture, which began about around 100 BC, okay, and flourished between 1 AD to 700 AD, created the majority of these lines. And you have other civilizations that came after the Nazca culture, and they probably added to the geoglyphs that are already there. The Nazca lines are located in the desert plains of, the Rio Grande de Nazca River Basin, an archaeological site that spans more than 75,000 hectares and is one of the driest places on Earth. So now, because it's one of the driest places of Earth, there is a theory as to why you have these Nazca lines created by the Nazca culture. But we're not sure if it's the exact reason or not, right? So this Mary Rishi, a German archaeologist, okay, concluded that the designs had an astronomical and calendrical purpose, right? They formed their calendars, and it had something to do with the stars and space. Okay, she further believed that some of the animal geoglyphs were a representation of groups of stars in the sky. Now, we have zodiac signs, okay, based on the constellation of stars in the universe. You have, Aquarius, you have Leos, you have Cancer, and they're all shapes of patterns of stars in the sky. And that is our constellations. Similarly, the Nazca culture had their own constellations, and they were probably drawing the constellations that they saw in the sky. Could be true. Some researchers propose the theories relating to aliens or ancient astronauts. So they say that, about 2,000, 3,000 years ago, civilization was not, you know, advanced enough to have technology to make these kind of designs, right, that are hundreds of kilometers long. So then they said that probably aliens have visited the Earth, right? Just like how there is life on Earth, there is life on some other planet in another galaxy. And they had better technology, advanced technology, and they came to Earth and they created these geoglyphs just to show that, you know, that they have visited the Earth. And it could be true, right? When anything is true, anything could be true in today's world, right? More recently, researchers suggest that Nazca lines, right? The purpose of Nazca lines was related to water. Because the driest place on Earth, you know, there was no water in that place. And any civilization to thrive needs a lot of water. Without water, the civilization cannot grow crops, right? And they will die of starvation. So they created these geoglyphs, okay, to appease the gods in the sky, right? To the rain gods and made offerings, and so that the rain gods gave them rain. Right? The geoglyphs weren't used as an irrigation system. They were not used for growing crops or use water for crops, right? But they were not even used as a guide to find water, but they were used as part of a ritual, right? So that they can offer to the gods and the gods bring them rain. Scholars point to the animal depictions of some of which are symbols for rain, right? Or water or fertility. So you can see some animals that were plants that were actually drawn on the planet. So these geoglyphs that resemble these animals were associated with water, and plants associated with water. So they formed a theory and said it is for the rains and is dedicated to the rain gods, right? So I'll leave it up to you to believe what theory you think is the most probable reason why the Nazca lines were created. Now I want to take you to another mystery known as the Stonehenge. So it's a beautiful location, an archaeological site. And even today, the exact purpose of why the Stonehenge was created is not known. So let me show you some photos of the Stonehenge and how beautiful this place is. So Stonehenge is a massive stone monument located near Salisbury, England. Stonehenge is just one part of a larger sacred landscape that contains many stones and wooden structures, as well as burials. So what you see, these pictures that you see are actually a small part of a larger place, right? There was a big temple or probably another bigger structure that was around the Stonehenge, but because of time, they've been withered away. And you only have these stones that are left. No one knows why ancient people built Stonehenge, but it seems to have been arranged to face the midsummer sunrise and midwinter sunset. So the location is to see the midsummer sunrise and to see the midwinter sunset, but we don't know why they were built. The structure that we call Stonehenge was built roughly about 5,000 to 4,000 years ago. So that's a long time. Okay. And it was part of a larger sacred landscape that included a massive stone monument that was 15 times the size of Stonehenge. So the other monument that was around Stonehenge was about 15 times bigger than what we find today. But because it's over 5,000 years old, most of it is not found. The biggest stones, okay, are known as sarsens, okay, and they are up to 30 feet tall and weigh up to 25 tons on average. So imagine a primitive culture about 5,000 years ago carrying stones that are 25 tons and that are 30 feet long. Did they have the technology to actually carry these stones? How did they bring the stones to this location? Where did they get the stones from? How did they erect these stones, which are so heavy? No, they didn't have modern machinery. At least we don't have proof of that. How did they do it then? The smaller stones are known as blue stones because they have a bluish tinge when wet or when freshly broken. They weigh up to 4 tons, and 4 tons is still heavy. It's impossible to lift, and you need the strength of at least about 20, 30 people to lift a stone of that size. The sarsens are widely believed to have been, brought. Sarsens are the big stones. They've been likely believed to be brought from a place that is about 32 kilometers away from the site. How did they carry stones that are so heavy from 32 kilometers away? The blue stones are believed to have been transported from a distance of over 225 kilometers from the site. So that's a fairly long distance to carry these stones, right? It's unknown how ancient people moved them that far. So again, you know, they had access to different types of technology that we don't have access to, or we don't know yet, because we have not discovered it yet, right? Hunting played a very important role in the area. Researchers have uncovered roughly about 350 animal bones and 12,500 flint tools or fragments just a mile away from Stonehenge. So people that actually built Stonehenge, people that actually lived around Stonehenge, right? They were hunters and they survived by eating meat of animals. That is what we understand. Dozens of burial mounds have been discovered near the Stonehenge, indicating that hundreds of people were buried there in ancient times. So probably Stonehenge was a sacred site and people were buried around the Stonehenge because they found a lot of graves of people who were buried 5,000 years ago. At least 17 shrines, okay, some in the shape of a circle, have also been discovered near Stonehenge. So you have places where people can, you know, offer prayers, and that is why we would say Stonehenge was a very sacred site about 5,000 years ago. Okay, a house of the dead was recently discovered near Stonehenge that dates back to 3,500 BC. My God, that's like about 5,000 odd years ago. So, you know, you had people who were buried. You have something known as House of the Dead. Some of the people who built Stonehenge may have lived near the monument, as a series of houses have been excavated near the monument. So maybe this Stonehenge was part of a big civilization that thrived around that was the epicenter of the civilization. And Stonehenge was the center, and you had people living around it. Recently, archaeologists have discovered evidence that people who lived in these houses feasted on meat and dairy products. So if you say that people feasted on meat and had dairy products, you know, they fed on dairy products, that means agriculture was already there. So people were not only hunting for a living, but they also lived and reared animals from which they could make their clothes and which they could have a feed off, basically. So you have like sheep, and you have goat, and you have cattle. So they basically, you know, used animals as part of their daily life. So they were not completely nomadic, right? They had some form of a lifestyle where they lived in a community as such. Okay, Stonehenge was built for the unification of Britain during a point when people across the island worked together and used similar styles of houses and pottery. So maybe, you know, people from different parts of Britain came here, okay, with different cultures, and they decided to say, okay, we are still united, and you know, they together built Stonehenge. It is arguably one of the most famous and mysterious megalithic monuments of the world today. And you know, if you do get a chance, you can go to England and you can visit the Stonehenge. Now, the Great Pyramid of Giza, and I'm sure most of you have already heard of the pyramids in Egypt. Right, I'm sure you've seen the movie called Mummy. There's so many movies, Mummy Returns, right? And the pyramids were always sought after, you know, by my generation. Like, you know, it was something that we really looked up to. And I have had the fortune of actually traveling to Egypt and entering one of the pyramids. I've entered the Pyramid of Giza, that is the biggest pyramid, and I've seen what is inside. And I'll talk to you about that in just a minute. But for now, let me show you the pictures. So these pyramids that you see are actually burial tombs of kings. All right, the Pyramid of Giza is the biggest pyramid among the three. All right, so the Great Pyramid of Giza is the oldest and the largest of the three pyramids, right? And the pyramid is the final resting place of the Pharaoh Khufu, who ruled in the 25th century BCE. It is made up of 2.3 million blocks of limestone, right? So when you see how the pyramid looks, the triangle structure, even today, we don't know how ancient Egyptians, right, brought these big blocks, okay, these 2.3 million blocks of limestone, and how they constructed the pyramid, you know, from inside to out, and how did they get the pyramidal structure? And there was so many things to the pyramid that I will explain right now. The weight of the pyramid, the size of the pyramid, it has a language of its own, all right? And you'll be really fascinated to hear the facts or truths about the pyramid. Well, let me first get to this. Khufu's sarcophagus. Now, what is a sarcophagus? Sarcophagus is basically a structure within which the king or the pharaoh is buried. All right? It is like a box kind of structure. And inside that, you have the mummy of the king that is buried inside. So Khufu's sarcophagus is a chamber, is inside a chamber known as the king's chamber. Okay? The king's chamber is lined with huge blocks of granite. And all that is there now is a huge granite sarcophagus, which once housed the pharaoh's mummy. So when you, if you go in, if you have the chance to enter the pyramid of Giza and you go inside and you see the sarcophagus, you'll only see the structure, the brass structure, but there's no body, there's no mummy inside. Once upon a time, there probably would have been a lot of jewelry, a lot of, you know, gold, a lot of precious stones. All that has been robbed, including the pharaoh's body. Everything has been robbed thousands of years ago. And today you don't have, you don't have anything inside the pyramid except the sarcophagus structure. Simple as that. Below the, below the king's chamber is a room known as the queen's chamber. Whatever treasure was inside the Great Pyramid was stolen long ago. For thousands of years, it has been reputed to be a tomb, although ancient Egyptians indicate that it was a compilation of knowledge of the reigns of God, and that it would prove to be a book in stone compiled by Surid, one of the kings of Egypt, right? And it's going to be deciphered in future. So they say the pyramid is not only a tomb, but it is actually a book that is written in stone. Okay, and maybe Egyptians had a language of their own, and they wanted to write, they wanted to save their language, they wanted to write some truths about life that they wanted the future generation to discover, and hence they made the pyramid. You know, certain measurements taken from the pyramid indicate an astonishing knowledge of the earth and the earth's place in the solar system. The information is expressed in mathematics. So now a lot of researchers believe that universal language is mathematics. Even if you don't understand a particular language, right? Anything can be explained in terms of maths. So Egyptians probably, you know, wanted to express the information in the form of mathematics through the construction of this pyramid. Now, if you look at the perimeter of the pyramid, right? The perimeter of the pyramid is equivalent to the count of days in a year, that is 365.24. Imagine constructing a pyramid with that exact measurement, right? About so many thousands of years ago. Now, if you, now doubling the pyramid, doubling the perimeter gives the equivalent of 1 minute of 1 degree at the equator. So they had this knowledge with them back then. The distance from the base of the apex of the slant, okay, on the side of on the side is 1/600 of a degree of latitude. So basically, they understood latitudes, they understood longitudes, right? And this is even before modern civilization could discover about latitudes and longitudes, right? The height of the pyramid multiplied by 10 to the power of 9 gives the approximate distance from the earth to the sun. You know, the perimeter divided by twice the height of the pyramid, okay, gives the value of pi, that is 3.1416. Considerably more exact than the figure arrived by ancient Greek mathematicians, okay, who said the value of pi was 3.1428. So through this pyramid, ancient Egyptians actually said the value of pi was 3.1416, right? The weight of the pyramid multiplied by 10 to the power of 15 gives the approximate weight of the earth. So they also understood the weight of the earth. So they're trying to explain all these facts just through the construction of the pyramid, right? As they said, it is a book in stone, right? The earth's polar axis changes in space from day to day, right? Bringing a new constellation of the zodiac behind the sun every 22,000 years and reaches its original position once in 25,827 years. A figure which appears in the pyramidal calculations, that's 25,826.67. So you can see, you know, when the cross diagonals of the bases are added together, so you can see that they understood the position of the earth in the solar system, right? They knew zodiac signs, and then if, and they knew how to transmit this information through mathematics, you know, calculating the weight of every single stone, every single block, the perimeter, the size, the shape of the pyramid, everything was clearly thought out, right? So that they could transfer their knowledge to the future. So it's not a simple structure that is triangular in shape, but it conveys so much of information. The measurements of the king's chamber within the Great Pyramid gives the exact dimension of two basic Pythagorean triangles, that is 2.5.3 and 3.4.5, although it was built several thousand years before Pythagoras himself lived. You know, so they already understood Pythagoras' theorem before Pythagoras could even discover it. They probably called it a different thing, but the concept they knew, right? Now, I want to talk to you about something that is found in our country. There's a place known as Unakoti, right? And this is located in Agartala in the state of Tripura. Okay, anyone can visit it, but it is such a baffling mystery. You can see these structures, the stone structures that are sculpted or carved out of rock, right? It is in our country and not many people know about it. I had the privilege of traveling to this place because my wife is from this place, right? And I traveled to this place to actually see these stone monuments, and it is a modern marvel. Okay? Nobody knows who built these structures and why they were built and how they were built. So let me show you some of the structures, some of the pictures of these structures, right? And this looks like Lord Ganesha, right? So you can visit them today. And just look at this. Unakoti lies about 178 kilometers northeast of Agartala in Tripura. Unakoti means one less than a crore, right? So that is 99,99,999, right? So Unakoti means one less than a crore. And it is said that these many rock cut carvings are available in this place. As per Hindu mythology, when Lord Shiva was going to Kashi along with 1 crore gods and goddesses, he made a night halt at this location. He asked all the gods and goddesses to wake up before sunrise and proceed towards Kashi. It is said that in the morning, except Shiva himself, no one else could get up. So Lord Shiva set out for Kashi himself, cursing the others to become stone images. As a result, we have one less than a crore stone images carvings at Unakoti. So that is one of the myths, one of the folklores as to why you have these many, you know, stone structures in this place. Can you imagine one less than a crore? So, you know, a lot of these stone structures have not yet been identified, have not yet been unearthed. Okay, but they say there's one less than a crore of these structures that are left in Unakoti. So there's a lot of discoveries to be made. Now, these carvings are located at a beautifully landscaped forest area with green vegetation all around, which add to the beauty of the carvings. The images are found at Unakoti are of two types, namely rock carved figures and stone images. You have beautiful waterfalls, a beautiful forest setting, and these sculptures or these images are hidden inside the forest. Right? The hill has been a Shaivite pilgrimage spot since the 7th century. So people who believe in Shiva, right? So they're known as Shaivites. So it's been a Shaivite pilgrimage spot since 7th century, so long ago. No one really knows how these rock carvings came into existence. No one even knows who made them because they haven't been marked. And there has been no proper exhaustive study on this architectural marvel. So we've not studied this properly. Researchers have not discovered a lot of information that is already hidden there. So we don't know who built it and why they built it, and even how they built it. They're such beautiful structures. Other theories on how the sculptures were made are like this. The locals believe that a sculptor named Kullu Kumar was the brain behind these stone carvings. Kullu Kumar was a devotee of Shiva and Parvati and wanted to accompany them to Mount Kailash. Shiva refused it, but he had to give in to Parvati's insistence. But he placed a condition over his agreement. He said that the sculptor was supposed to carve figures of 1 crore gods in one night. When morning arrived, okay, Kullu had sculpted almost all the sculptures except for one. As a result, he was refused entry into Kailash. And that is why they said there's only one less than a crore structures in Unakoti. imagine, guys, this beautiful heritage site is in our country, right? And not many of us know about it. You know, deriving from the figure of Kullu Kumar is another legend, is another story as to what, how Kullu Kumar came about these, you know, these sculptures. Kullu was given the task of carving 1 crore gods and goddesses in a dream. However, Kullu Kumar carved out his figure amongst those deities. Hence, the figures of gods is one less because there is a human sculptor among them. So he carved about 99,99,999 god figures, but one he made of himself. And that is why it is less than one less than a crore. Now, if we find the sculptors behind the carvings or the time period of them, okay, we can actually trace the areas to which the cult of Shaivism was spread. And added to that, we can actually discover a new civilization, okay, and their Mayan-like disappearance. So Mayan is another civilization that disappeared. So even this civilization that actually built these structures suddenly vanished. We don't know what happened to them. We don't know who they are, right, and how they ended up in this place. And why did they actually carve so many structures? But one thing is for sure, if we do a little more research, right, and if we do a little more digging, we'll find out more structures and we can hopefully discover this new civilization, okay, that was part of our country and that made these beautiful sculptures. We might also find the city, right, where they lived and, you know, discover a whole new town. We don't know, but only research can tell us and we need time. And I hope, you know, the Indian government takes note of it and they start putting in more effort in discovering this lost civilization that lived in, you know, Agartala in Tripura, a beautiful location, beautiful site to visit. So make sure whenever you go to Agartala, you go to Unakoti and you have a look at these structures. It's beautiful. I've been there, I've seen it, and it's amazing. So that's about it for today's class. I hope you enjoyed it. And, you know, there's so much out there that we don't understand. Even with all the information, all the knowledge, all the technology that we have, we humans don't understand a lot about the past, right? Many theories revolve around aliens. They said aliens would have come to the Bermuda Triangle. Aliens would have come here. Aliens have made the Nazca lines. That could very well be true. We don't know. So let us wait in time. Let us do more research. And in the meantime, if you really like what I've spoken about today, right, put a comment, go to the YouTube channel or go to the Facebook, Narayana group page and write about what more you want to see, right? Or at least write about what you've discovered based on your research. Do a little more reading on all these things that I've spoken about today, and we'll meet in the next class. And I'm waiting to read your comments about today's class. Thank you, guys. Yeah, have a wonderful weekend and I'll see you next Friday.